好，系啦，咁我哋而家
collection。We are now convening the Subcommittee on Property Management Services Ordinance Commencement Notice 2020 and Property Management Services Licensing and Related Matters Regulation. So the first item is to elect a chairman, and according to the procedures as set out in the relevant rule book, we have to nominate members, and we have to have one oral or verbal nomination, and then we will have to have at least one other member seconding the nomination. And then the nominated member would also have to accept the nomination. So can I have nominations first? Yes, I'd like to nominate Holden Chow. Any seconder? Okay, Mr. Cheng Hang Pan second. So Mr. Holden Chow, do you accept the nomination? Okay, so we have one nomination now. Do we have another nomination? So we only have one nomination. So I'd like to ask again, is there any other nomination? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, if there is no other nomination, then I now declare that Mr. Holden Chow has been elected ipso facto, and he'll be the chairman of the subcommittee. So I'll hand over the floor to the chairman. All right, thank you, members. Do we need to have a deputy chairman? No need. All right, then let's move on. Item two, let's invite the administration team to join us. Thank you. We have got a list of officials attending our meeting. So I'd like to now invite the administration to walk us through the Property Management Services Ordinance Commencement Notice and Property Management Services Licensing and Related Matters Regulation. And then I'll open the floor to members' questions. So over to you, please. Thank you, Chairman. Well, the two pieces of subsidiary legislation. So in accordance with CAP 626, Property Management Services Ordinance, that's about the commencement notice, and also the PMS Licensing and Related Matters Regulation that have been set up by the PMSA. So through the licensing of, through the issue of licenses, we are to regulate property management companies and practitioners, and we'd like to enhance the professionalism of the industry for providing quality property management services to the community. And the SHA has already designated the commencement data for the PMSO and also the related legislation. And there are certain provisions that have not been commenced, and that's 1A, 2A, and 3A. And these three clauses will come into effect on the 1st of August 2023 in order to enable the relevant companies and also the personnel to have a transitional period. With regard to the licensing and related matters, I'll defer to the chairman of the PMSA, who will walk you through the relevant details. Yes, over to you, Mr. Tony Chen. Yes, thank you, Chairman. Well, for property management, it has everything to do with our daily life. That's why the PMSO was enacted a couple of years ago, and the purpose is to set up this PMSA. And through the licensing system, we'd like to regulate property management companies and also practitioners in the industry. And the PMSA has been set up, and since its establishment, we have been working very hard to regulate the trade. And after some extensive consultation, we have now acted in accordance with the subsidiary legislation of the PMSO in enforcing or implementing the licensing regime. And I'd like to take the opportunity to extend my gratitude to the practitioners for their contribution to the legislation and also the subsidiary legislation. They've given us a lot of views, and the PMSA during the past year has been looking at the views submitted by the practitioners on the subsidiary legislation and also the licensing regime. We have enhanced quite a few of the initial provisions, and because of the active participation and exchange with the stakeholders, the subsidiary legislation has been extensively supported by the trade. I hope that this council can enact the legislation as soon as possible so that the licensing regime can be implemented as early as possible. And as Ms. Lee just said, actually we would have a third stage of transition so that everybody will be able to adapt to the new regime. And we expect that both the public and the stakeholders will be looking at how the property management companies should be regulated and also how the practitioners should be regulated. And we would also like to promote the industry in terms of its integrity, competence, and also professionalism. So I'll now defer to the CEO, Mr. Alan Seal, of the PMSA, who will walk us through the details. Okay, over to you, Mr. Seal. Yes, thank you. I'll briefly talk about the subsidiary legislation. The purpose is to issue license to regulate PMCs and PMPs in order to enhance their professionalism so that they can provide quality property management services. Sorry, Mr. Seal. In fact, our members have already read the papers, and they understand the situation. I understand that your presentation is going to be very detailed. Given the fact that they have already understood the situation, then can we allow them to ask questions first? Because actually there are several meetings going on in parallel, and therefore they might have to rush to another meeting very quickly. Okay, Mr. Xu Ka-chun. Well, in fact, I don't have questions. I've been involved since the very early days of the PMSO. And in fact, in 2019, both in January and July, I met with the stakeholders as well as the HAB and also the PMSA, chaired by Mr. Tony Chair. And under the leadership of Mr. Chair, we've been having meetings with the practitioners. And I'd like to say thank you to Mr. Chair, because initially the practitioners were somewhat worried because how a balance can be struck between the interests of the trade and also the enhancement of the professionalism of the industry, because over the years the public and also the stakeholders and also the companies have been having this discussion, and there was some dispute on controversy about this, and two meetings were held with the HAB and also the chairman of the PMSA. They listened very carefully to the anxieties and concerns of the trade, and fortunately different stakeholders have been expressing their views, and that's why at this juncture, as far as I am aware, well, the stakeholders asked me to take up the issues on their behalf, and they are now happy with the situation, and they understand the intention of the administration. And I personally do not have very strong views, but then I was helping the profession, and I would definitely support this. Thank you. So that's by way of your observation. So I'll defer to Mr. Siu again, and then you can walk us through this, and I'm sure our members already understand this. So you can be very brief, please. Okay. So other than what Mr. Seo just said, that is the industry has been maintaining very close liaison with him. And I'd also like to thank Mr. Seo, because under the Eastern District Council, at one of these subcommittees last year, we also had an exchange with them, and they gave us a lot of views. And our colleagues also went to the Eastern District Council and had a discussion with them.
So I have a brief introduction to the subsidiary legislation. So let's focus on the licensing part. That is, property management companies, they need to get a license, and they have to provide the management, and the property management participant also needs to get a license. The frontline workers, such as the cleaners or the security, they don't need a license, so they are not affected by the licensing regime. Now, regarding property management services, we have seven categories. There is general management, that is under building management, cap 344. Under the covenant, there is a management services. These are provided by the property management company. There's also cleaning, security. And third, we have repair and maintenance. Fourth, there is finance and asset management. And fifth is facilities. Sixth is human resources. Seventh is legal services. So they need to provide at least two categories of service to be deemed to require a property management license. If they only provide cleaning and security, they do not, under our licensing regime, need to apply for a license. Just now we mentioned, in order to have the industry more time to get accustomed, we have a 3-year interim period. During the 3 years, the property management participants and companies, they can choose, but they are not required to get a license. We understand that the industry, they are a lot of experienced workers. They might not have the professional qualifications or academic qualifications, but they have work experience. So under this system, during the interim period, they can apply for an interim license. It can last for a maximum of 3 years. And during that time, if they can take up prescribed courses, they can apply for the license. So as we said just now, and when we drafted the subsidiary legislation, we conducted a lot of public engagement, including meeting with the District Council, Home Affairs, LegCo. The industry supports the subsidiary legislation, and we hope that through negative vetting, the legislation can be approved, and we hope that it can be implemented on the 1st of August. So after the briefing, I can open it up to Q&A. The first, Mr. Kotwaikau. Let's also set a time limit of 5 minutes. You can follow up. Thank you, Chairman. The first question is for you, because it is just roughly a month away from summer recess. So, Chairman, how many meetings do we need to scrutinize this bill? And even though it's negative vetting, I want to clarify this. That's the first question. Second question is targeted at the Property Management Authority. So the PMSA, back in the day when Mr. Wong Kok Heng in the District Council, he mentioned that, and when he entered the legislature, he was a proponent for this, and now we finally see the Property Management Authority, and on 1st of August, we will have some specific measures and projects. That is very heartening. But the public views on property management companies, they have a lot of complaints. So we hope that the authority can set guidelines, work guidelines, such that the industry can be regulated as soon as possible. Now, regarding this legislation, aside from enhancing the regulatory regime for property management companies, we are also creating another career ladder. It's a new job category. It gives young people a career path. So it's also stable. Even during the COVID outbreak, it's not affected severely because we need property management on a daily basis. It's not affected by economic cycles. So this, I think, is a stable industry, and it is worth promoting to the younger generation. So the industry also wished to clarify. They now have 7 categories, and if they can provide 2 services or more, they need to get a license. Now in Annex C, it's quite clear that it has to be necessary, whether it is 1+2, 1+3, or 1+4. Now, if I just have 2+3 or 5+6, do they need a license as well? Why do I ask that? Because aside from applying for a license and being regulated, the industry is worried that if they have 2+3, 4+5, 7+5, they need a license. So will that lead to confusion, and the public will feel that they are providing property management services and lead to more competition? You have to provide a portfolio of services to undertake property management services. But now if you just manage finances or facilities, you can allow them to manage property. So the management quality might differ from company to company. So is that a legitimate concern? Well, as chairman, let me answer your first question, and then I can hand it over to the government officials. Thank you, Mr. Kok, for your reasonable question. Now, we need to notify you. Now, these 2 pieces are subsidiary legislation. The content is simple, and the government has already taken us through it. So I hope members, now my observation is you support the legislation. And of course, we need to sort out the details. In the past, the House Committee work has been suspended, and we're now at the end of this legislative year. So I hope if we can complete the scrutiny as soon as possible, then we can meet the deadline in this term so that it can take effect on the commencement date. That is my plan. But I'll give you sufficient time to raise questions. So I will try to do my... Well, if it's negative vetting, do you need to submit a report to the House Committee? Now, I have a legislative timetable. Let me report. The deadline should be 24th of June. So this is just for a reminder, but I don't want to waste your time. We do have a concurrent meetings. Would they have to be dealt with because of the backlog, and I don't want to take up the time slot. So let me hand it over to the government officials. Let me speak first. Thank you, Mr. Kok, for your support. As Mr. Kok said, while we drafted and consulted the industry regarding the licensing legislation, a lot of work was done concurrently, including the courses, negotiations with universities, and approving statutory bodies and acknowledging their qualifications. So we have guidelines and such, but without the legislation, we cannot proceed. That because we have to have some gazettal notice, so we need to endorse the legislation before we can conduct a formal work, but it is concurrent. Now, the seven issues, seven services allow Mr. Xu. Mr. Xu can respond. Thank you, Chairman. First of all, there are seven categories of services, and as long as they provide two types of services, then they need to get a license. So it is not category one, it has to be mandatory. But your concern, we understand. And in the past, when we consulted the industry, there was concern on this topic. For example, if you provide category two environmental services, security and cleaning, at the same time, you need to conduct facility management work, but your focus is on environmental services, cleaning and security. So you provide facility management, it's just supplementary. So we will still consider you as one category rather than two categories. So similarly, if you provide facility management, but you also provide financial or asset management work, so it is just considered part of facility management. You won't have two categories where we won't require an extra license. Let me supplement. You're worried that the property management company, the service provision, they might, because it straddles two categories, they might not be properly proficient, but it depends on the license, so the license holder. We have a requirement, and I can go into greater detail. That is the main focus, because the company relies on its staff. So the licensing regime, the company providing property management services, they need to recruit staff that have a license, the property management participant. The licenses would depend on what kind of work they undertake, and this is something we can manage. The other question was about complaints. So even though we haven't issued licenses, we are handling complaints, but we don't have the authority where we can have a process to deal with the license. But in the past, through our colleagues, we have coordinated efforts, and the dissatisfaction arises out of misunderstanding. Some people withhold the information, but a lot of these are resolved through our efforts. And as I said, the property manager or the company, we have some basic requirements. We have work guidelines and such. And if they don't comply, then they would be in breach of the licensing requirement. So there is a process, and the legislation describes how to deal with it. So now I foresee in the future, aside from more communication and requirements, such as people require certain information, can photocopies suffice? We cannot charge exorbitant photocopying fees. Something simple should not be stalled, and we also have requirements regarding transparency. So, Chairman, if you want more details, my authority colleagues can supplement. Mr. Xu or Mr. Zhang? Chairman, let me supplement. First of all, the license holder and licensing requirements. There are some requirements requiring, for example, academic qualifications and property management work experience. As to any breaches against our guidelines, so these would be disciplinary issues. They would be breaches of the licensing requirements, and according to the legislation, we can undertake investigation and we can have an inquiry. And ultimately, if the authority decides that there has been a breach, then there are different levels of discipline, from a warning to fine, and more. At the extreme, we can even revoke a license.
Next, it's my turn. I have a question for the administration. Well, since the information about the subsidiary legislation has been published, there are some questions from the community. Well, as said just now, well, for the company providing property management services, all right, for the frontline staff, they don't have to get a license. So that has to be clarified, because some of the frontline security staff are worried, because with this in place, then do they need to get a license? No, that's not necessary. So you have already clarified that. So please do clarify that once again. Next, is it possible for you to come up with a clearer set of guidelines? For example, in the future with PMCs, well, I believe that for the larger companies, it should be easier. But then for the relatively smaller PMCs, will there be clear guidelines for their staff? For example, for one PMC, how many management staff would there be? And at which level would they need to get a license? And who will be getting a license and so on? So in the legislation, after its commencement, can you issue guidelines to these companies so that they will be made aware of that? And then the company will then be able to tell their staff. That is, let's say if there are three management staff and all three of them will have to get a license, then everybody will be reassured. They know who the licensing regime is targeting at and who will need to get a license. Thirdly, in the licensing process, according to the paper, for those who have already got a recognized qualification, academic accreditation, and so on, but then there are others who have a lot of experience. For example, the more senior PMPs. So they might have taken up or taken some courses, but then they will have to pay for those courses. So what about the tuition fees or fees for those courses? Well, to be fair, if you ask these security staff to enroll in one of those courses, and then within 3 years, they would have to apply for the license, and then they would have to pay out of their own pocket for such courses, then that's not really very good. So in this regard, I'd like to clarify with you, would there be any support from the administration? Or if it's a very clear requirement, then the companies will have to pay for their courses. So would that be the case? So who can answer the question? Yes, I'll try to answer the question, and then I'll ask Mr. Seal to give you more details. First, you refer to explaining the details to the trade. Yes, we will do that, and thank you, Chairman, for giving us your views. Under the subsidiary legislation, who would need to get a license is very clear. But then, in terms of publicity and briefing the trade, we will continue to do our part so that the trade will have no doubt about this. And then I'll defer to the CEO to tell you more about who will need to get a license. I think this is very important, because if there is any misunderstanding, okay, I'm just working for a PMC, and if everybody needs to get a license, then they'll be very concerned. So will they lose the job? So in the legislation, we have considered that very carefully already. Okay, Mr. Seal. Thank you. as the chair just said, well, in our PowerPoint presentation, we have already set out that, well, for the practitioners, only those who are providing jobs of management or who play supervisory role. So only those who assume a managerial or supervisory role in a PMC will be required to take a license. And then for frontline staff, like security staff, they will not be required to get a license. That's very clear. And the chair also referred to guidelines that in a PMC, well, at the lowest level, how many staff will be needed. In fact, the PMSA has already consulted the trade, and we have already come up with an arrangement. So within a property, let's say if there are 3,000 units or less, then at least they'll have to have one tier one licensed PMP, and if they have less than a, if they have up to 1,500 units, then they will have to have at least one tier two licensee. So that's the minimum requirement, and the PMC will have to meet the specified or prescribed requirement, or else they will be breaching the relevant legislation. And as the chair just said, well, for the grandfathering arrangement, for those who have had a lot of experience in the trade, but then they may not have acquired the professional qualification or academic qualification. As I said, during the transitional period, they can apply for a provisional license, and then if they are able to complete the prescribed courses by the PMSA, then even if they do not possess the necessary qualification, they will be able to get a license. As to the cost for such courses, well, for recognized or accredited courses, there are four tertiary institutions that can provide or offer such courses, and they have already applied for the inclusion in the Continuous Professional Education Fund. And three have had their applications accepted, and the remaining one will shortly be recognized as well. And therefore, for these grandfathered property managers, if they enroll in one of these courses, then they will be able to receive subsidy or allowance under the Continuing Education Fund. And then for the professionals, if they enroll in continuous education, then they will already have obtained the $20,000 subsidy on previous occasions. So we have discussed that with the trade, and many PMCs actually think that if their staff get professional qualifications or enroll in certain courses in order to upgrade their skills, then there will also be support from the management or companies. So with the implementation of the licensing system, of course, PMCs will have to ensure that the practitioners will be able to meet the licensing requirements. And I'm sure many companies, where necessary, will be prepared to offer more support for their staff to enroll in these programs. Yes, Mr. Siu, you already answered the question. Okay. If they apply for the Continuous Education Fund, they'll be able to get $20,000. And then, of course, some of them will use that. But then there are others who might have already enrolled in some other courses, and they might have used up the $20,000 already. And therefore, they can only rely on the PMC, which will have the good intention, so that given the fact that there is this legal requirement that you have to have a license, and of course, you would also expect the PMC to offer this support for them. So you're expecting the PMC to subsidize subsidize their staff in undertaking these courses, right? Well, as we have said, well, if the PMC is a licensed company, then there is this minimum requirement. So let's say if they're running some 3,000 units, then they will have to have at least one tier one and then two tier two licensed staff. So long as they can meet the requirement, it's okay. But then It's possible that some PMCs might have more than this number of licensed staff. And if they don't mind, some staff might also want to get a license. The reason why we have to have this three-year transitional period, that's because the fact that we have this three-year transitional period, it depends on whether or not you like to get a license. And for these staff, they can also get a provisional license. So theoretically, that can be up to 6 years because of the 3+3 arrangement. And during this period, you'll be sharing this up because we are talking about a credit system. And of course, in the process, for the four institutions that are involved, we have this requirement. So we have already set the maximum fee that they can charge for these courses. And of course, we can supplement on the figures. But we don't think that will put a lot of pressure on them because we are talking about giving them a specified period before they have to meet the requirement. And therefore, while they are working, they should be able to get a qualification and they should be able to get a formal license because there is ample time for them to meet the requirement. And for the PMC, well, it's about them nurturing their own talents so that they can enhance the competence and professionalism of their staff. And they would also culture or nurture this sense of belonging to the company so that they can continue to work for the company. So that's what I'd like to supplement. And in scrutinizing the courses to be offered by these institutions, we're looking at the number of hours, that is the contact hours, and also the substance of the course, that is the curriculum and so on. And of course, members might be concerned about the fees that will be charged by these institutions. So I'll defer to the PMSA. Mr. Seal, can you tell us roughly how much are they going to charge for these courses? Yes, thank you, Chairman. Well, for institutions undertaking these courses, we have engaged different institutions because the purpose is to ensure that there will be competition, and then that would also ensure that the fees will come down. And according to the figures that we have received for the four contractors or institutions, in detail, the fees will be different. In particular, they will have to consider the teacher qualification and also where the courses will be held. And the price differential is about $4,000. And therefore, in the design of the curriculum, well, there is this element of competition. And also for Tier 2 courses, the cheapest will be just $9,000. And then for a Tier 1 course, it's about $13,000. So that's about the fee level. Okay. Yes, Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, a follow-up question. Yes, Chairman. Had I known that we can have this face-to-face discussion, then I would not have needed to make arrangement to meet with you separately. Well, according to the trade, well, out of the seven categories, if they are able to provide two, then they will have to get a license. And then the profession did ask this question. That is, theoretically, well, for category one, why is it so special? Because they will have to meet, or they will have to take up the managerial role under the DMC. So Cat 1 is the exceptional clause. All right, it's already there. So I'd like to clarify. Is it possible to distinguish, well, for the OCs and also individual owner, how can they tell whether or not this licensed PMC, whether or not they have been providing services under Category 5 and 7? So will they be able to take up the role of a property manager under Category 1? So that's the concern of the trade. That's point number one. And of course, you talk about the Tier 1 or Tier 2 license. So how can they tell whether or not they can take up the role of a manager under the DMC? That's the most important part of it. And secondly, there are some problems. All right, for some PMCs, they might claim that they have a history of 30 years, but then what's coming up is that they're trying to get both licenses. All right, let's say if they can get a license in August, that's the earliest. So does that mean that throughout the territory, all PMCs can say that, well, we only started to get a license in 2020. Can they still claim that I have 25 years or 30 years of management experience? Can they still make that claim? Because in the trade, there are some old shops and some would claim to have a long history and rich experience and so on. So in the future, if these PMCs say that our company has established for 25 years, but then you just got the license. So would that be a breach of some of the provisions? So you'll have to clarify that.
So do they all say that we got licensed for a year and we are now engaged in this business? Let me defer to Mr. Xu. Mr. Xu, Chairman, the question was the property management company, regardless of what services they provide, is this information discernible from the license? Well, when we issue a license, we will have a registrar in our authority website. So you can check up the relevant information of the license holder, but they might not indicate what type of services they are engaged in. So as Chairman said, they want to recruit licensed property managers with Tier 1, Tier 2 managers. So the staff would have the relevant work experience to provide property management services. So to a certain extent, it's a quality assurance. And then during the interim period, the PMC or PMP can wait till the last minute to apply for a license. They are not required to get a license at a particular stage, but they just required to get the license within 3 years. So when the company was established and when did they receive the license, these are two separate types of information. There's no direct relationship. Chairman, I just want to add Mr. Kwok's question. I want to add to that. A company's business reputation or goodwill, of course they can provide information. So if somebody wants to recruit them for property management services, they can ask when were they established or what they have managed previously. But we're concerned whether they meet our requirements to receive a license and what kind of people they have hired. They have to be license holders. Mr. Xu, our CEO, said that we have the information on the website, including when they received our license. And when they received our license, the services they have provided at which estate or which properties. And in the future, if the company receives a complaint, and after our process, if there's a conclusion, we will also disclose this information. So as I said, these are two separate issues. How long have they been established? What have they done? That they can describe themselves, but when did they receive a license and whether they have a track record or a complaint history, it will be disclosed on our website. But the public can say that whether they want to investigate, and we are willing to provide this information. It's transparent. We want to know how they perform after the license has been issued, but what they had did before the licensing, the company, the relevant people can provide proof through other means, or they might have a business reputation that they could rely on. Well, I do have questions. We did participate in the scrutiny of the legislation. They have to provide two types of services, and they need to apply for a license. We wanted to regulate a wider scope, and we wanted a lower threshold. But as a matter of fact, we now have a scenario where when we scrutinized the main legislation, there was public engagement. Home Affairs did so. The consultation, we had targeted professionals, building managers, building management companies, and the industry. So the public's input was not large or sufficient. So if a member of the public wishes to engage a licensed company, they won't know if it's a general license or whether they can be a manager that can handle the work under the deed of covenant. So there is no information that they are regulated and they are authorized to undertake work specified in the deed of covenant. So this is what the owners, property owners, are telling us. So can the PMSA resolve this issue? Otherwise, I might have inadvertently recruited someone who cannot perform the services I require. Is that possible? Another concern is they have recruited a management company with a license. Will that give rise to other questions or problems? PMSA. So the manager under the deed of covenant. Just now I emphasized that a company, they are providing certain services. They hire certain staff. The company itself cannot do anything. So the threshold is this uniform. So when company A has staff of a certain level and company B has a higher qualified staff, if you look at the manager or the supervisor, our requirements are quite stringent. So aside from being a member of a professional body, they also need academic qualifications. And these academic qualifications are related to his profession. And there's also an issue of work experience. So if you cannot recruit these type of people, licensed professionals, then that company cannot get a property management company license. I understand Mr. Tier's description. We do have frontline unions. They say in the past people dare not undertake work that is beyond their capabilities because they might lose their license. But the public don't. The public might have a list of 10 companies. But now, let's say we have 100 companies with licenses. So this is a matter of some concern. And of course, the owners can have a tender exercise. But we just want to provide the consumer with more information. So perhaps you can think this over. Mr. Xu would like to elaborate. I think the registrar I mentioned just now can provide some information to the public. In our registry, the law requires that the PMC needs to describe how many licensed managers are working for them, and the types of units they manage, and whether there is one deed of covenant or more than one deed of covenant. So all this information is available to the public, so they can check the track record of the company and the business of the property management company. So I have a follow-up as well. Now, I have an opinion regarding the course fees. The cheapest course is $9,000, and tier 2, and $13,000 for tier 1. Now, Chairman said this is a fee that is payable over a few years. So, even though it can be divided over a few years, it's not a big sum. But the frontline workers will now have to bear $10,000 costs. So if we can give a pledge, let's say the continuing education fund can foot the bill, but if it cannot, then if the PMC can subsidize the course fee, then I think the frontline workers would feel very grateful. So you might not specify that in the legislation, but in the future, you might want to check. Some people might have already taken courses using the Continuing Education Fund, and they would like the company to subsidize them. So I hope the PMSA could look into this, because the role of the PMSA, if you're aware of that information and you communicate with the property management companies, they are under some pressure. We want to encourage you to do better, and you exert some pressure on them, and they can subsidize their workers to take these courses. Thank you, Chairman, for your input. Of course, we want to encourage the PMC to upgrade its workers to meet our requirements. So it's good for their image or their operations. So in light of Chairman's input, we will communicate with them. Well, we don't have the authority to tell them to provide this subsidy. And perhaps the Continuing Education Fund. I had asked the government to relax the ceiling. It's not enough. We need a two-pronged approach. And third, I want to point out the four tertiary institutions, three of them have already committed that the course fees could be paid through the CEF, the Continuing Education Fund. So we are working on it. We want to minimize the impact on the license applicant. We want to reduce the financial impact. The course, we have them available on Hong Kong Island, in new territories, and the class hours are also flexible. So this is are working with the education institutions and provide flexibility. Some people prefer a certain schedule. Some people like it broken up. And thanks to our stakeholders, they had reflected these views. So in the last few months, we have streamlined these operations. We want more people to upgrade themselves and have continuous professional development. Now, just now you responded, how many licensed workers would a company need to have? You said it was based on whether they match 3,000 units or 1,500 units. So let's say we have workers ABC working for a management company, and one manager requires tier one, and ABC three workers, they have similar work experience, they have a similar work level. So put it more bluntly, so A, B, or C, who should get the license? Now we receive these questions as well. Who the company will designate to do the work? So when the legislation is endorsed, will you require the company to tell the workers as soon as possible? So ABC, well, the workers ABC, you have, well, only one of you will have to get a license, and that person will need to make the application and start the process. Is this what will happen? And that's my follow-up.
Thank you, Chairman. Well, if that company needs to get a license, then of course they will have to specify a manager as to who out of these three managers should get a license. Well, he'll be the one in charge. If there should be any problems, then the one who is licensed will have to be accountable. So there is this autonomy given to the company. So whoever is, in the view of the company, suitable, then the company will have to give the name of that individual. And he will also have to be licensed, because in the future, he'll be responsible. So as to the number of units under the management of the company, well, we will require the company to have the minimum number of personnel who are licensed. Let's say if they are managing more than 3,000 units, then of course they will need to have more than one person who is licensed. So that's the legal requirement. Let's say if they have 3,010, then they will need to have two who are licensed. Is that understanding correct? Correct. Well, then that's more or less my question. Okay, Mr. Kwok. In fact, we can ask until 6:30. Well, another question is, well, when it comes to property management, it's not an easy job. Because in some cases, they might be able to take the lead in many things. But then in other cases, they'll just follow the instruction of the OC in carrying out their duties. Well, both can be the case. And then some might criticize the PMC for being bad and so on. But then there are some that are doing a very good service. Well, when I was a district councillor, I only became a lawmaker since 2012. And then when I was a district councillor, well, I would used to have some two or three OC meetings in a week, sometimes even on weekends. And sometimes it's very long meeting. So yes, there would be this 3-year grace period, but then would that be enough time for them to complete the courses? Well, they might have enrolled in many courses previously, and they might have contacted different institutions in order to meet the needs of the trade. I hope that the PMSA will take a look at the fees charged by these courses, because some institutions might be overcharging because they might try to make a profit out of it. As we know, well, when you try to learn how to drive, you can also get allowance under the continuous or continuing education fund, but then the course fee will be somewhat higher than normal. So you know full well that is already a monopoly, and yet it can still overcharge if they know that you can get a government subsidy. So I have to ask this question, because in the community, we have this employment support scheme, and then when you apply for this, you're talking about $9,000 for 6 months, so that's the maximum. So that's up to half of your monthly wage, and then for a company trying to get that subsidy under the EHSS, well, you cannot blame them. But then it's on an accountable basis. So for most companies, that's not part of their running cost. And they will definitely be able to get it back if it's accountable. So after they have got the allowance under the ESS, how come it's not returned or plowed back to the OC? I don't understand it. So I hope that the PMSA can also make sure that these BMCs will not just pocket the money. They will plow it back to the OCs, because I do have some expectation on the work of the PMSA. To what extent are you able to do it? Who is to answer? Well, I'll try to answer the question first. First, it's about those who have been in the trade for a while. And Mr. Kwok was concerned about the grandfathering provision. That's not for 3 years. Theoretically, it can be up to 6 years. The reason why we have to have this three-year transitional period, because by the end of the three-year period, they will still be able to apply for a provisional license, and therefore it can be up to 6 years. So that can be up to 5 years, if you want. And then we are also concerned about the fees charged by the tertiary institutions. That's the reason why we have reached a consensus with these institutions, and indeed there are provisions or clauses regulating the tuition fees. We have agreed to set a standard fee for these courses. First, we have to consider the affordability, and second, about the quality of the courses. And third, they will also have to be of a certain standard that can meet the institution's requirements. And then for the $9,000 under the ESS, we have also talked to the relevant stakeholders. Well, as the PMSA, first, that's not under our purview. We don't have any power over that. It's not to be paid by us. If it's under us, if we are able to pay that, then of course it's nice. But then what can we do? We have to think about it. But then we simply do not have any powers. We also have to understand that for the $9,000 under the ESS, it's also not something granted or given to the HAB. And obviously, it's also not given to the PMSA. So I don't know whether the HAB or the or Mr. Seal might have some thoughts on this. Well, we understand your concern, but then I don't really think there is much that we can do about it. Yes, Mr. Seal. Well, for the employment support scheme, it's under the Labour and Welfare Bureau, the LWB. As to how it's formulated and how it's to be implemented, we don't have any role at all. Yet we understand the concern of the Honourable Member. And earlier on, some OCs also approached us to express their concerns, and that has been passed on to the LWB for consideration. Well, let me put it this way. I understand, and I find Mr. Kwok's concerns very reasonable. I've also received some inquiries, and we have also approached the professional bodies and also the Bureau Director to express this concern. Well, once you get the allowance under the ESS, it should have been returned to the OCs concerned. But then, number one, that's not under the subject of discussion today, and it has nothing to do with the PMSA. But then, we will have to follow up on this. And then please note this very important view, okay? Mr. Kwok, you have something to add? Yes, Chairman, I agree with what you said. Of course, we can also write to the PMSA and ask it to take up the matter, because we have this concern. Okay. I think members have already asked some questions. Do we need to invite the public or deputations to give us their views? Because I've already explained the urgency of the passage of the subsidiary legislation. So after we have discussed it, and also because of the time constraint, we may not take that step of holding a public hearing then. And if there are no further questions, then we can move on to the cross-by-cross examination. So, administration, can you help us with the cross-by-cross examination? Yes, sure. Well, first, I'll go through the Property Management Services Ordinance Commencement Notice 2020. In fact, the clause reads as follows. Under Section 1.2 of the Property Management Services Ordinance, Cap 626, I appoint the commencement data, that is 6.1a, 2a, and 3a. That's the exception. And also, 1st of August 2023 is the day on which Section 6.1a, 2a, and 3a of the ordinance comes into operation. As to the Property Management Services Licensing and Related Matters Regulation, the PMSA will be following up on that. And so that's all for the commencement notice. Okay, so on the commencement notice, any comments? If none, then I think we have dealt with that. So that's by way of a notice given by the Secretary for Home Affairs. And then for the regulation, I think the PMSA will have to help us. Okay, PMSA colleague, can you walk us through that? Yes, thank you, Chairman. Well, the PMS Licensing and Related Matters Regulation has a total of 14 clauses, and then 4 schedules. Clause 1 is about the commencement, and it comes into operation on the 1st of August this year. And second, Schedule 1 prescribes property management services for the ordinance, and Clause 3 is about the fees. And Schedule 2 prescribes the fees payable for the matters specified in the schedule. Clause 4 prescribed information that must be contained in applications for licenses and provisional PMP licenses and for renewal of licenses and so on. And under Clause 4, in fact, there are 3 types of license. What A and B would be for PMCs and also PMPs. And if they are submitting a new application, then they will have to provide contact details and particulars of the applicant and so on. And then Clause 4.2, there are 2 paragraphs, A and B. It's about the PMC and also PMP applying for licenses, but then it's about the renewal and also the information that has to be furnished. And then 4.3 is about those applying for provisional PMPs, and there is no question of renewal, and therefore it's only about a new license application, and also the particulars that have to be furnished, for example, the contact details and also the qualification and so on. And then Clause 5 of the regulation, there are 3 paragraphs. In fact, Clause 5 is about licenses, provisional PMP licenses, and also for renewal of licenses, and also the attached documents that are prescribed. In other words, when they submit their application, they will have to enclose certain documents. And then under 1 and 2 of subclause 3 is about the prescribed documents that they have to furnish for renewal. And then under subclause 2, it's about the PMC and also the PMP. When they renew their licenses, they will also have to furnish certain prescribed documents. And then subclause 3 is about the provisional PMP. Well, they will also have to enclose certain documents. So that's about clause 5. Yes? Sorry. Because I was listening to your explanation. But then I'd like to pause and ask a question. Well, first, on the fee, it's set up in the schedule, so that's about the fee that they have to pay. But then for PMCs, for the $18,000, that would be paid by the company. But then for the PMP's license, tier 1 is $3,600. So who will be paying for this? So does the applicant have to pay for this? $3,600 for tier 1 license. Thank you, Chairman. Well, for the application fee, Well, in the principal legislation, it's already provided that you will have to pay at the time of submitting the application. As to who is going to pay, well, that is for them. But then the license is for 3 years. Let's say for $3,600, you're talking about the license fee for 3 years. Okay? Well, let me take a look. And I can see that both clauses 4 and 5 have set out that there are certain documents that the applicant will have to furnish at the time of application. And then after the license has been issued, well, for the PMC and also PMP, well, basically, there are very clear names set out in the license, right?
So as Chairman said, Chen Taiman is the prescribed person. They have the license. So in the future, in the PMC, this PMP will list that person's name. So the public will also be aware of that. Am I correct? First of all, the license will have the license holder name. And subsequently, starting from clause 10, we will talk about the PMC and PMP conditions. So the conditions will require the PMC for each property that they manage, they have to have a tier one manager, and they have to display clearly this tier one manager's name and his license number. So to answer your question, yes, the residents of the property will see the license holder's name. So the company's name will be visible, and even the manager's name will be visible. Please continue. Clause 6 has the prescribed criteria for holding PMC licenses. There are two sub-clauses. I mentioned they need to have a Tier 1 license holder. They have a minimum staff level requirements. Clause 7 is about prescribed criteria for holding PMP. And there are three sub-clauses. In sub-clause 1, there are four conditions for applying for a license. They are a senior, they have a lot of experience, and they have, the second is having academic qualifications, the third is renewal of license, and fourth is a renewal criteria. Subclause 2 states some restrictions regarding the experience, and subclause 3 is the definition of a recognized professional body. Now, in clause 7, we talk about the criteria for holding PMP tier 2. Clause 8 is about PMP tier 2 license criteria. So it's similar to clause 7. We have two subclauses, and we have the first application for license, renewal of license, temporary license criteria, and so on. Clause 9 is prescribed criterion for holding provisional PMP licenses, and they list work experience requirements and so on. It also lists the work criteria. The work experience has to be at a higher level than tier 2. Clauses 10 and 11 are the conditions that we can exercise on PMC licenses. Clause 10 is about prescribed conditions on PMC licenses. There has to be a tier 1 manager managing each property. Clause 11 is conditions on PMP tier 1 or PMP tier 2. So these conditions include continuous professional development requirements. They are listed in the different sub-clauses. Clause 12 is the prescribed conditions on provisional PMP licenses. The conditions we can apply are the same as a proper license. The proper license holder can manage a property. Clause 13 is about the provision of prescribed information to clients by licensed PMC, and that is listed out in Schedule 3. The last clause is Clause 14, and through Schedule 4, we have notification of changes of prescribed matters. And this information needs to be notified to the PMSA. The method of notifying the PMSA is listed in Schedule 4. So, Chairman, are there any questions relating to these 14 clauses? Otherwise, we can move on to the four annexes. Now, I want to ask, I see Clause 10 and 11, where you say the prescribed condition on PMC licenses, the name, the license number, and whether it is pamphlet or commercial advertisements, I have to include that. And in a visible area of the property, so each building or estate is different. So in your implementation, this is what the text says. You say you have to display it in a visible area. So you want to safeguard property owner interests. You want people to know who's responsible for managing the property. So what do you mean by a visible area? Is it the lobby? Do they have to list all their license holders? Thank you, Chairman. We note that even without the license regime, in the lobby area, there's a label where it says that the property is managed by a certain company. So the PMSA, our complaints division, will conduct spot inspections. We will tell consumers that PMCs have a requirement where they need to display the information in a visible area. We will provide guidelines on what it means, what visible means. We will tell them what visible means. Clause 13 and 14, I noticed that the change in information. So if there's a change of prescribed information, what is the time allowed to provide any change in information? Regarding notification of changes, we listed out the conditions in Schedule 4. So Schedule 4 has two scenarios. If there are any changes, the license holder has to use specified form in a written manner and notify the authority within 31 days. And they also need to provide supplementary information. So the two scenarios are listed in Schedule 4 in paragraphs A and B. In paragraph A, we say that in the application form, just now in our clause-by-clause scrutiny in Clause 4, we had already talked about that. So if there's any change in information, they have to notify us in 31 days. And in paragraph B, the changes relate to the changes in the license. Let's say they were a member of a professional body, but for various reasons, they do not belong in that professional body anymore. They have to notify us within 31 days. We also have information related to the license. If they're prescribed tier one manager, if they change the person, they have to notify us within 31 days. So that gives rise to a small problem. So let's look at it from the property owner perspective. We now have legislation describing who is a license holder, what license they hold. You have inspections. But some owners, they discover, they identify a problem, or they feel there's a problem. So after this law takes effect, how do they lodge a complaint? Do they contact PMSA? This is from the owner perspective. So owners might participate in the management. They might notice that information does not correlate with their understanding. So do you have a dedicated group within PMSA to handle complaints? Chairman, the principal legislation authorizes the PMSA to investigate any complaints. So when we handle complaints, we issue guidelines. So owners, the public, visitors, if there are breaches made by the PMC or license holder, they can lodge a complaint with the PMSA. Now, I mentioned we have inspection department and complaint department. If there's evidence, we might hear a discipline. We might hold a disciplinary hearing. Chairman, I want to add that it's not limited to complaints. PMSA colleagues regarding licensing or management, if there are any problems, our colleagues are willing to provide information, especially if it's related to licensing. It doesn't have to be a complaint. They can seek information. Our colleagues take the initiative to communicate, because all this is new, is brand new. Well, then I think, let me ask the secretary or legal advisor any questions. Legal advisor might have some questions. Clarification in clause 8. PMP Tier 2 license, the prescribed criteria, you list academic qualifications that the applicant must possess. In subclause B, you have a bachelor or higher degree or academic qualification, and in D, it says any other qualification that is considered acceptable by the authority. So I want to clarify, what qualification will the authority consider? What is the process? Let's say the applicant qualifications don't meet your criteria. They are assessed by the authority, or does the authority issue information on a regular basis that degrees other than ABC are acceptable? Thank you, Chairman. The legal advisor referred to subclause D, any other qualification that is considered acceptable by the authority. The authority has already made some announcements. The other qualifications, we have decided that under the qualifications framework, there is a previous qualifications acknowledgement. So the worker, if they have certificates, if they have earned certificates that are recognized, and if they have 5 Tier 4 certificates, we can accept it as qualifications acceptable by the authority. So during consultation, we received feedback from the industry, and they said it's very hard to recruit people into the industry. These workers did not major in property management, so they need different channels to recruit people into the industry. So other acceptable qualifications, we will make an early announcement after the consultation. The PMSA principle regarding qualifications compared to A, B, and C. Our PMSA members, it will not be inferior to the other acknowledged courses or courses offered by institutions. Well, so you mean that you've already contacted the four tertiary institutions to provide future qualification courses? Is that what you mean? I don't want to misunderstand. Just now, I referred to a principle. Property management legislation will last quite a while, and so whether you provide courses or the recognized courses, these might be upgraded. So, for example, we might not be using a lot of IT in the past. So as times change, we might need to enhance knowledge in this area. I understand what you're saying. So that means there's a regular increase of requirements. So this is what we consider. And as Chairman said, you asked a focus question. Mr. Cheung can supplement.
Thank you, Chairman. In fact, for someone who has had a lot of experience in the trade without the professional qualification, and if he wants to get a formal license, well, that would be somewhat different. So we are talking about an alternative pathway for those who have been in the trade for some time, and then through such a recognition of qualification or experience that they'll be able to get a license. Thank you. My apologies. Give me some time to go through this, because there was one more question that I'd like to ask. But yes, so it's about Schedule 3. So Schedule 3, can I refer you to 1A? Because I noticed that for licensed LMC, if they provide information to their clients, so it's about information concerning conflict of interest between the PMC and the PMC's clients. So that's about the prescribed information in the best knowledge of the PMC. So what kind of information is this? Is it that, under the license, the PMC, let's say, there might be some conflict of interest between the company and a certain clients, and the company has to provide the information. So can you give us some examples? Yes, thank you. Well, one of the examples is, let's say if there is a PMC which is managing a property already, and then on behalf of the owner, so let's say if it has to award a cleansing contract, and if out of the contractors bidding for the contract is a subsidiary under the PMC, or if you have directors who are connected parties to the PMC, then those would constitute conflict of interest, and under the rule, in the best knowledge and also belief of the PMC, then in accordance with Schedule 3, the PMC will have to notify the relevant owners as quickly as possible. So that's also a licensing requirement. As soon as you find that you find out that there is this conflict of interest, then in accordance with the format provided for under Schedule 3, you will have to provide the information to the owners. So that's as soon as reasonably practicable, sending a copy of the prescribed information to the owner's organization of the property, in other words, the owner's corporation, and so on. So if there is such information, then you will have to send a copy to the owners. Yes. Chairman, so we haven't really gone through the schedules. Do we have to ask Mr. Zhang to go through that? Sorry, I was going faster than we have done. Okay, schedule one is to prescribe what's meant by property management services. In fact, there is a table, but then there are three clauses before the table, and clause one is about how we can interpret this. For example, subject to sections 2 and 3 of this schedule, column 3 is about the services specified, and then column 2 is about the category of services and so on. And then clauses 2 and 3. Clause 2 sets out that the duties and obligations performed by an owner or owner's organization pursuant to the BMO are not property management services. And then clause 3, as we referred to just now, it says that a property management service incidental to and necessary for the provision of a property management service under a category of services in column 2 of the table is regarded as a property management service under that category only. So in other words, if it's repair and maintenance, and if you have to clean up after the service, then you treat it as two services, and therefore you will have to get a license. No, that's not the case. And then for the table, that would also set out the 7 categories of services. So that has been set out in column 3. So that's the substance of schedule 1. And then schedule 2, as we just said, for the different fees and charges, they'll be set out in table 2. In schedule 2, it's about the application fee for the license and also the renewal fee. And also, if any individual would like to search for any information under the register, they would also have to pay a fee, and that's also set out in Schedule 2. And then Schedule 3, as we said, it provides that for a licensed LMC, they would also have to provide prescribed information to their clients, and that has been set out in Schedule 3. Other than what we said about conflicts of interest, they would also have to notify the clients of what is set out in para B, that is contracts and documents relating to property management. So any contracts and so on, they would also have to notify the clients in the prescribed format. And then the last schedule is schedule 4, is about notification of changes, as we have just explained. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to know more about schedule 3. I think that's clear, because you talk about as soon as reasonably practicable, and then under B, you will have to send it to the owner's organization, or you will have to display a copy of the prescribed information in a prominent place in the property. And then B says that, if you have paid a copying fee, then within 31 days, you will have to provide the receipt to the clients. So for licensed PMC, okay. So that's Chen Taiman, who is the licensed PMP. But then if he fails to fulfill this, then as an owner, if I spot this problem, all right, I'll tell him that you will have to tell me. And if he fails, then I'll ask that Chen Taiman, because he's the person in charge. He's the licensed PMP. So is that understanding correct? So if I know that Chen Taiman is the licensed PMP for that PMC, then if he fails to supply the information to me, then I'll have to contact him. Yes, the PMC will have to specify the Tier 1 PMP. And then for any problems that the occupants may have, of course, they can always approach the PMP, or they can also write directly to the PMC. Yes, very often for the individual owners, if they want anything, then they may not directly talk to the licensee. So they may not approach the manager. But then given the fact that he's responsible for managing that property, we would expect him to formulate the plans for enforcing or executing the plan of the company. So we do have this expectation on him. So he will have to fulfill certain expectations. Let's say if there is this requirement of sending the information to the owner within 31 days, he has to do it. And if he fails that, then on that part, he has already failed his duty. Okay? Okay, if we have already finished with the Chinese version of the clause by clause, then can I ask the legal advisor if everything is okay with the English version? Board Chairman, I've checked both versions. I haven't found any drafting problems. Okay, thank you very much. Then I think we have already finished with the clause by clause examination if there are no further questions. Well, before I move on to the final part of this, I'd like to ask one more question. Well, I just talk about the tuition fee for the course, and then for Tier 2, the minimum fee would be $9,000, and then for Tier 1, it's $13,000. Is that right? So together, so have you found out what's the highest fee being charged and a related issue? Is that for the four institutions that have contacted you or that have discussed with you, then what about the number of hours? So 5 hours or how many hours? So that's my last question. So what's the duration of the course? How long? Well, Chairman, for the Tier 1 course, the minimum fee is $13,000 plus, and then the maximum is $19,000. So close to $20,000. And then for Tier 2, minimum $9,300, and then maximum $12,000 plus. And then for the course hours, for Tier 1 is 120 hours, and then Tier 2, 80 hours. According to our estimate, given the number of hours, so it will take 30 to 40 classes, and you should be able to complete it in 6 months. So the target is about 6 months. So completing those courses in 6 months. Well, as the chairman just said, in terms of the class hours, there will be some flexibility. For example, that will be classes will be conducted during weekends or during their spare time. And there are four institutions that are offering these courses. We have already coordinated with them. So they are located in Hong Kong, Kowloon, and the New Territories. So there'll be different institutions offering courses in different locations. So in both Hong Kong, Kowloon, and the New Territories, in order to provide convenience to the trainees. Well, to be honest, 120 or 80 hours, so a total of 200 hours. Well, however hard you try to split that, you're talking about 3 or 4 hours a day, and then that will take quite a number of weeks to complete the whole course. And I hope that you can be more flexible with the trainees. Yes, you might say that it will just take 6 to 12 months to complete the course. But then for them, the working hours are already quite long, and if they have to spare time to undergo the course, that would be rather time consuming. So in dealing with that, please be as flexible as possible. So that's my final view. Okay? If there are no further questions, then about the remaining procedures, okay, end of scrutiny should be the 24th of June, and then deadline for notice of amendments, 17th of June. And if I understand it correctly, Secretariat might need to correct me if I'm wrong. Well, originally, we should report to the House on the 12th of June, but now there is a need for us to extend it to the 15th of July, and then we'll report to the House on the 3rd of July. And then for the notice, for the date of giving notice of amendment, that will be extended to the 8th of July. Is that correct? If that is the case, then please note that. That being the case, then we will seek an extension of the scrutiny period. So the expiry date for scrutiny period is 15th of July, and the deadline for giving notice of amendment is 8th of July, and then date of reporting to the House Committee would be the 3rd of July. Okay, if there are no further questions, and we have completed the scrutiny of this subsidiary legislation. So without further ado, we can now adjourn the meeting. So once again, I'd like to thank the chairman and also government officials for coming. Thank you.